The letter to the Romans has been pointing out man's guilt before a holy God. From its earliest words, we have learned that every person is a sinner, separated from God, and heading for deserved judgment at the end of the age. This is man's natural, desperate condition. He is under the condemnation of sin and the law, and he is hopeless to do anything about it. Now that's bad news, right? But rays of light have been appearing more and more frequently as we moved into chapters 5 and 6, and that light will shine positively brightly now as we've come to chapter 8. Yes, you heard that right. There is light for your darkness, and there is hope for your despair. Good day to you, and welcome to the teaching ministry of Grace Missionary Church. This is Pastor Doug Carlson again with you, and we're about to start a journey through what has been called the greatest chapter in the greatest letter in the entire Bible. Romans chapter 8 marks a major change in the focus of the letter, and we will start our important study in this wonderful chapter after we pray. Again, Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, thanking you that we can do so. I pray your blessing, Father, as we would take these few moments together to study what you have written for us, what you have provided for us. We thank you that this is your word. It is forever established in heaven. It is exactly what we need. It does not change. It cannot be taken away from, Father, or added to. This is the truth, absolute truth, from Jesus the Father, the Spirit, from God himself. I pray your blessings, Father, as we would look together at your word. I pray that you'd make changes in our understanding, that you would challenge our hearts, that you would make us more like Christ because of our time spent together in your word. And I pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want you to take a look at a couple of things here. First of all, Paul has been moving us right from what we were to what we are. And that all comes into focus now with the reality that we have in Christ. So that's the first thing I want you to see, is the reality of our new position, the reality of the position that we have. Verse 1 begins with the word therefore, and it introduces the result or conclusion of the first 7 chapters of the letter. And what a conclusion it is. For that natural condition that we talked about a moment ago, that we are under the condemnation of sin and the law and hopeless to do anything about it, we have a new position where there is no condemnation for believers. Let me read that verse for you. It's a great one. Verse 1 of chapter 8. Therefore, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Let me read that again. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Now the condemnation that Paul references here encompasses both the sentence and the punishment for sin. And he says, we don't face either one of them anymore. There is no sentence hanging over us, and there is no punishment ahead of us, because the penalty has been paid, because our guilt is gone, and because our future is secure. So later he says in verse 34, who is he who condemns? Well, the answer is no one. No one can condemn, because we are in Christ. Now, the agent of all the blessings that we have as Christians is the Holy Spirit of God. And you will find, amazingly, that the Spirit is mentioned 15 times in the first 17 verses of this chapter. So the Spirit of God is a major emphasis, not in his relation to the Father and the Son, though that, of course, is legitimate, but really in his relationship to us, what he does for us, how he interacts with us and ministers to us in his part of the Godhead. Now, the Noah verse 1 is quite emphatic. There is therefore now no condemnation. The placement at the beginning of the verse makes this very clear. So the message is that there is absolutely, positively, not even a hint of condemnation for us, because God has forgiven the overwhelming debt of our transgressions and has imputed his own righteousness to us. Now think about that a minute. If you're a Christian, if you're a child of God today, who can condemn us and what can accuse us? If we are in Christ, nothing separates us from his love, as we'll see later in this marvelous chapter. So it's very emphatic, and it is very much a blessing to know that we are no longer condemned. We are beyond the reach of condemnation. But as we saw in chapter 7 graphically, I believe, this doesn't mean that we don't sin anymore, not completely. And when we do sin, we don't lose our salvation, because that's impossible, but we lose the full enjoyment of our salvation. See, the union remains, but the communion is affected until we deal with the offending sin of the moment. So I want you to see a couple things here when we sin. First of all, when we sin, and we will, we're going to be living in Romans 7 until Christ takes us home. But when we sin, we should always admit it. Now that sounds easy. It's certainly important, right? Because acknowledging failure is the first step in a return to fellowship. But we still have this sinful pride, and we don't like to admit that about ourselves. Even Christians don't like it when a sin is pointed out in their lives by the Holy Spirit or by one of the saints. They just don't like it. It doesn't happen automatically, that's for sure. There is another struggle of the will. And Paul said in chapter 7, to will is always present with me. Now I want you to look at 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 through 10. Hold your place here, because of course we're coming back. But 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 through 10. Because I want you to see that there are three people here in this passage, 1 John 1, 8 to 10. Each of them is a professing Christian, and all of them have sinned. That's what they have in common. What they don't have in common is their response to that sin in their life. And I think it's very instructive for us as we think about this, because even though there's no condemnation, and positionally we're secure, in practice we still sin. So we should always admit sin. Here's a problem, though, if you're the person in verse 8, because this one disputes his guilt. Let me read it for you. Verse 8. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. This is a person, professing Christian, who claims to have no problem with sin. Sure, he makes the occasional mistake, but he believes his salvation has left him on a higher plane, entire perfection or sanctification. He doesn't sin anymore. He's unaffected by the temptations that bother the rest of us. Well, this man may or may not be truly saved, but I'll tell you what, he is deceived. He is deceived because what he is saying is not true. He should know better. Now, that's the first person. The second person denies his guilt outright. He doesn't just dispute it. He denies that he even has any sin. And that's in verse 10, this person. If we say that we have not sinned, do you see the difference? Verse 8, if we say that we have no sin, no current sin, no problem with sin. But in verse 10, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. This is somebody who claims to not have a problem with sin at all. This is a problem who thinks that he doesn't have any sin. But no sin nature means no forgiveness, no need for forgiveness. And that means no need for Christ. Now think about that. If you're actually trying to tell somebody that you don't need forgiveness, you don't need a Savior, you're not saved. You haven't come to grips at all with what God has said, and you're defaming God because it says here you're making him a liar. Why is that true? Because God has clearly said throughout the scripture, and we've seen it a lot of times in the letter of Romans, all have sinned. So for some puny man, some person to arrogantly say, I don't sin, I don't have a problem with sin, well, it's arrogance, and I believe this person, by calling God a liar, is doomed. I don't think he's saved. Now, there's a final person here, and that's right between the two, and that's verse 9. Let me read that one. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Surely you see the difference between the person in verse 8 who says, I'm not sinning, and the person in verse 10 who says, I've never sinned, and the person in verse 9 who says, oh my, I have sinned, and I've gone against the Lord. Confess in verse 9 is a very important word. It means to say the same thing as, or to agree. In this case, it's to agree with God that we have sinned. It's a night and day difference from the guys in the surrounding verses. This is God be merciful to me, a sinner, rather than sins. What sins? You see, a truly born-again believer will respond as verse 9 tells us. Whenever he gives in to the temptation to sin, he will admit his sin, he will take full responsibility for it, and he will humbly ask the Lord to cleanse him and fill him again with the Holy Spirit so he can live the way that God wants. This is the way that we should admit our sin. This shows that we are not just professors of salvation, but possessors. That's what King David did when, after he sinned against Bathsheba and Uriah. Listen to his words from the Psalms. I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Now later on he prayed in the 51st chapter, restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Well, that's the way to do it, friends. When God points out a sin in our lives, he's our Father, we're his child. We don't respond by denial. We don't respond by disputing. We declare, we agree, we say, oh yes, I am so sorry. Thank you for pointing that out. Thank you for loving me enough to point that out. Cleanse me from that particular transgression. Now, we're not asking for salvation because we're already saved, but we're asking for the Lord to restore us to fellowship. I quite often say, Lord, if there's anything, after I've confessed the things that he's revealed to me, I say, Lord, is there anything that separates between me and you today? Would you remove that as well? And would you fill me with your spirit? That's my daily prayer, sometimes more than once a day. Now, the Lord always hears that prayer, my friends, because David talks about this later in the 103rd Psalm. And I love this. He says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. And here they are. Who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Amen. That's where we want to live the Christian life. There is no condemnation. That speaks to our position. No one can lay a hand on us. No accusation will stand against us because we're the redeemed, blood-bought body of Christ. We are the bride, and he is the bridegroom. And yet, we let him down, don't we, when we sin? And we know it, and we feel it, don't you? If you're a Christian brother and sister, don't you feel it right away? We don't have to wait till we get to church on Communion Sunday. Something, and that something is someone, right? The Holy Spirit talks to us, whispers, nudges us. That was wrong. You hurt that person. You thought that thought. You did this thing. And we go, oh, that's not what I want. I want to serve you. And so we confess. We say, Lord, that was wrong. And he says, I know. And I love you. And we say, fill me with your spirit. That's how it works. So the first person is deceived. The second person we talked about is doomed, but this guy, the true believer who does the right thing and admits his guilt, is absolutely delighted. You can hear it in David's words. So when we sin, we should admit it. A second thing happens, and this is really kind of cool. Jesus Christ himself advocates for us. We admit the sin. He advocates for us and pleads our case, if you will, before the Father. Right now, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the throne of the Father in heaven. And he says in 8:34 back in Romans, who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us, for the saints, for those who are trusting in him. Intercession is the act of intervening on the behalf of another. And no one intervenes better than Jesus. Listen to 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. My dear children, I am writing this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate who pleads our case before the Father. He is Jesus Christ, the one who is truly righteous. That's a wonderful thing to know. That when we sin, he's talking to believers in both cases, when we do sin, Jesus is our advocate in heaven. And the Holy Spirit convicts us to admit, to confess, to come clean. And we do that wonderful, brief, but important process of being cleansed and restored to full fellowship. And we can walk with the King. We can walk in the Spirit. So here's the connection with Romans 8:1. Our soul is cleaned already because of Christ, so there's no condemnation. But we kind of get our feet dirty as we walk through this life, and God helps us enjoy our new position by getting us back on track. in daily practice. So the reality of our position is that there's no condemnation for believers. Now, Paul reminds us of the next thing here, of the reason for our position, and that's in verses 2 and 3. The reason for our position is right here. If you're with me in Romans 8 again, let's jump in again. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. So Christ has delivered us from the law, the principle, or the operation of sin and death. That's what he's talking about in verse 2. Again, it's not the Mosaic law. He says it is the law of sin and death. It is the principle. It is the operating force in our lives before we're saved, and Christ has delivered us, past tense, he's done it for us, we aren't self-delivered. He has delivered us from the principle or the operation of sin and death unto a new principle, a new way of operating of life in the Spirit. The key here is saying we are now free. We are not condemned because Christ has taken the condemnation. We have been delivered by another. We are free because of Jesus and only because of him. Now, through the act of justification, what we've been studying since chapter 5, we are identified with Christ. And listen now, we are also united in him, identified with Christ. But not just that, we are actually united in him. That's why later we'll find out that nothing can separate us from his love. Paul states in 1 Corinthians 12:27, now you are Christ's body and individually members of it. My friends, in a way that we can't fully fathom, Christ's divine life pulses through us. Now, verse 3 is an early gem in the chapter. It speaks of the substitutionary atonement that is the heart of the gospel. Let me read it again. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of our sin, and he condemned sin in the flesh. What the law, the Mosaic law, couldn't do, it was weak, it was powerless to fulfill God's righteous requirement, right? That's what the verse says. Jesus Christ clearly, perfectly did. It reminds me of Ephesians when it says, but God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. He took our place. He became our substitute. That is the reason for the reality in which we live every day from now on. It's not because of us. Couldn't be. Never would have been, won't be, but because of Christ, because we're found in him, we have these marvelous blessings that we see just laid out for us like diamonds on top of the ground in Romans chapter 8. This fulfills scripture from the Old Testament, like Isaiah, for example, Isaiah 53, verses 4 through 6. And it's so important that we understand this substitutionary atonement, that Christ took our place, because we couldn't do this on our own. You see, and we couldn't, only he could. And so this is how he connects it to us, right? Why his payment can be applied to our account. Isaiah 53, verses 4, 5, and 6. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Amen. Amen. So there's a position, there's a reality in our lives that no one can take away. There's a reason for that, Christ and what he's done. And now there's a result of our position, and that's what I see back in Romans 8 and verse 4. Here it is. We can now live the kind of life that God intended for us all along, a life of personal holiness. Look at verse 4. that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, that walking according to the Spirit instead of the flesh is key here. You see, the flesh principle, our innate sinfulness, has always been the problem. We've seen that since the beginning of our study, have we not? The Old Testament describes human works this way. We are all infected and impure with sin. When we display our righteous deeds, they are nothing but filthy rags. Like autumn leaves, we wither and fall, and our sins sweep us away like the wind. That's Isaiah 64:6 in one of the newer translations. I want you to see then that apart from the inner working of the Holy Spirit, even a believer's efforts at righteousness are useless. The flesh was no good to us before salvation. My friends, the flesh hasn't gotten any better. It is still not by works that we please God. Yes, again, we've mentioned before, there's a command to be holy, but our part in that is to confess the sins that the Spirit convicts us of, and then to walk in the Spirit, right? Galatians 5:16, in day-by-day dependence, because then we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. But if we try to not fulfill the lust of the flesh in our own power, we will fail, and we will fail miserably and spectacularly. So we have to understand that it's the Spirit that does it, but the Spirit of God lives in us, every believer, so we can indeed walk in Him. And there are good works that God has prepared beforehand for us to perform. Remember that in Ephesians 2:10, so we're not saved by good works, but we're saved unto good works, a life that He has prepared beforehand for believers to live. Not to get saved, we took care of that earlier, but instead to demonstrate that we are saved. He wants us to live what verse 4 says. He wants us to live in the Spirit and not in the flesh. This is speaking of sanctification, not salvation. Now, when we were in bondage to sin, we couldn't obey. But now that we're free, we can. In fact, Paul says later in Philippians, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Jesus talked about this too in his famous John 15 passage. I love this text. It's a great discipleship chapter, chapter 15 of John. When I was really learning about what discipleship meant many years ago and seeing how important it was and seeing how the complexity, if you will, how much more of our life is caught up with discipleship than we think, this passage was huge for me. And I want you to read for you just a couple of verses, John 15, verses 4 and 5. Jesus says, abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Without him we can do nothing. Paul says, with him we can do all things because he strengthens us. What a blessing. What a blessing. You know, these are just four verses, and it's just, I hope, whetting your appetite for greater, even greater things to come as we get into the text. But we're done already with these four verses, and I want to ask you a very personal question as we bring this to a close. Are you feeling condemned today? Has life beat you down? Does it feel like everyone and everything is against you? Does the awful weight of sin and guilt make you fear for your future? Well, you're not alone, my friend. All of us came into the world condemned. Scripture tells us that. We were condemned by the law. We were condemned by our own sin. We feel guilty because we are guilty. Guilty before a holy God. But the message of the gospel is that Jesus Christ came into the world to save those who are condemned. That's why he came. John 3 says, for God sent not his Son in the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him would be saved. He came on a rescue mission. Jesus himself said in the Gospel of Luke, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. The whole message of Scripture is, yes, it starts off with our sinful condition, that's the bad news, but then it brings us to the good news of who we can be in Christ. Scripture provides a beautiful picture of this whole thing of Christ taking our condemnation and changing and turning it around. In John chapter 8, let me remind you what happens there. Jesus has just come down from the Mount of Olives where he was praying. He is met in the temple courts by a group of Pharisees and teachers of the law who have devised a scenario to try to trap him in his words. They brought with them a poor woman who was caught in the act of adultery, and they ask him, what should be done with this sinner? Now, her guilt is not in doubt. She was caught in the act, and the law of Moses prescribes death by stoning for this offense. But what will this man, known for his mercy and compassion, say? Will he let the woman off the hook and thereby show contempt for God's law? Or will he agree with her accusers and exact the full penalty of the commandment? Well, Jesus does what only he can do. And we need to watch closely, my friends, because this is how he deals with all of us as well. The law was given to point out man's sin and to drive us to Christ for forgiveness. Our Lord honors these purposes by forcing everyone present that day to come to grips with his own guilt, with his own sinfulness. He says it this way, he who is without sin, let him cast the first stone. Yes, he says the law is important, but no one has kept it perfectly, not this accused and not all of you accusers. The law points out sin, but it is powerless to remove it. And if you try to live by the law, you will die by the law. Law isn't the way to forgiveness. And when Jesus asks this in his convicting way, they one by one slink away with heads lowered and eyes averted because they know that they are sinners too. And it leaves the Savior and the sinner all alone. Jesus graciously asks, where are your accusers? Has no one remained to condemn you? No one, she replies with amazement. Then he says these incredible words, neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. She doesn't argue with the master. She doesn't deny her condition. She doesn't dispute her guiltiness. But she leaves forgiven because Jesus chooses to deal with her not on the basis of the law that she has broken, but on the basis of his coming death for the sins of the world. Think about that. The law is legitimate. The law does provide the righteous standard of God. The law has been broken in this case, but the law is broken by everyone. That's why Christ came. And the law has done its job right here, and it has pointed out this woman's obvious sin. And listen, it has brought her to the feet of Jesus. And by her acquiescence, I believe she's receiving forgiveness. And that from this time on, she will be different. Jesus dealt with her not on the basis of the law that she had broken, but on the basis of his coming death for the sins of the world, including her sins, including my sins, including your sins. So as we close, have you experienced the joy of coming in condemned and going out forgiven? Let Jesus put you forever beyond the reach of condemnation as you accept his offer of salvation today. And then the words of greater from mercy me will be words that you can claim in your own life. Bring your tired, bring your shame, bring your guilt, bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name? You will always be much more. When I wrestle with voices telling me that I'm not right, I can hear another voice who is calling me redeemed. And greater is the one living inside of me than he who's living in the world. Bring your doubts, bring your fears, bring your hurt, bring your tears. There'll be no condemnation here. I am holy, righteous, and redeemed. Well, there'll be days I lose the battle. Grace says it doesn't matter because the cross already won the war. He's greater. He's greater. I am learning to run freely, understanding how he sees me, and it makes me love him more and more. He's greater. He's greater. Isn't that a great freedom and release to know that you are in Christ, that your past has been taken care of, that your present is sweet, that your future is secure? You can have that, my friends. Come to Christ. the greater one and receive everything you need. Well, that's my prayer for you as we leave, and I look forward to seeing you again real soon.